It is 2 p.m. and the time to start the meeting. I welcome you all to this 87th annual general meeting of our company. The requisite quorum being present, I call the meeting to order. Proxies and authorizations have been received for 14.52 crore equity shares, rupees 10 each, which is 55.22% of the company's paid up equity share capital. Registers, documents and records as required by law are open for inspection by the members. I wish to introduce to you my colleagues on the dais. To my left, Shri S.S. Kohli, Raina Karani, Shiv Prabhat and my colleague Lalit Jalan. To my right, my colleague, one of the foundations of Reliance Infra, Satish Seth, Shri Ravi Kumar, Dr. Chaturvedi, and Shri Galkar. The annual report for the financial year 2015-16 has already been circulated to you. I request the members to permit me to take the notice convening this meeting as well as the auditor's reports on both the standalone and consolidated audited financial statements of the company for the year ended 31st March 2016 as read. Thank you. I now request Shri Lalit Jalan to give us an update on the business of the company.
Thank you, Chairman. I would like to start today's proceedings with a favorite quote from our legendary founder, winner of the prestigious Padma Vibhushan, Shri Dhirubhai Ambani. He used to say, "If you can dream it, you can do it." I had the proud privilege of working many years when he was around us, and have amongst my most precious possessions many of the blessings that he gave me. Welcome, dear shareholders, to your 87th annual general meeting. A very good afternoon to all of you. I have divided the presentation into three sections. The first talks about the performance of your company over the last year, then a business update on each of our various businesses, and third, and very critically, an update on the human capital, the CSR, and the many awards which the company has won. If I put on two slides the critical achievements achieved by the company across each of the businesses. In our roads business, all our roads are revenue operational and they are very high quality roads. In our metro rail, over 21 crore passengers have travelled in a very short time of 27 months, which is a world record. And if we look at the 2 kilometer catchment area around the metro, which is what is defined typically for a metro's catchment area for the people who would ride the metro, each and every person staying in that area on an average has used the metro 50 times over the last 27 months. In our distribution business, we have added 2.7 lakh new households in Mumbai and Delhi. In our transmission business, all our three projects with a total investment of 4,600 crores are operational. And in defense, we made the acquisition and management control of Pipavav Defense, now renamed as Reliance Defense and Engineering Limited. During the year, your company has won two arbitration awards from NHAI for the two road projects that we had constructed a few years back. The total award won is to the tune of 170 crores. We also have 14,000 crores worth of arbitration, which is under advanced stage. And we expect decisions to be coming out on those in the near future. Just in the last 2 weeks, Government of India has taken a major initiative to give a boost to the infrastructure sector. The arbitration process was very cumbersome, and these could easily be challenged in courts of law, and stays could be obtained, and the companies which had won the awards had to wait for many years before getting their money. Government of India has passed a new mandate through the cabinet that any Government of India department or company, should they lose an award, have to pay 75% of the amount when they go to appeal. This will mean faster release of cash to your company, and it will also mean that gives us additional capital for future growth opportunities. During the year, we completed 100% sale of our cement business to Birla Corporation Limited for a price of 4,800 crores completed in August 2016. Between signing the deal and completing the transaction, we could complete it in less than 6 months, which is a very, very quick time for a transaction of this size. We continue to unlock value for our shareholders through sale of our road assets, as well as 49% minority stake in our Mumbai power business. We are very focused towards debt reduction, in spite of the fact that we are at 1-to-1 debt equity ratio, which is the lowest in the industry. Our chairman has guided us that we should move to as close to zero as possible. The reduction in debt will lead to increase in profits for our dear shareholders. If you look at the financial performance of your company over the last 10 years, across all the critical metrics, the company has grown between 3 and 5 times. If I look at the revenue, we have grown from 4,600 crores to 19,000 crores. The EBITDA of the company has grown more than 4 times, from 1,300 crores to more than 5,500 crores. If I look at the profit after tax, which all of you are very interested in, we have gone from 650 crores to 1,975 crores. And if you look at the net worth of your company, it has gone from 7,800 crores to almost 28,000 crores. This means an average annual cumulative growth rate of almost 15% across all the major parameters over the last 10 years, which is a very creditable performance. Coming to business update, distribution business. Your company is India's number one private sector distribution company. We are by far the largest player in the sector. We distribute more than 6,000 megawatts of power to our valued customers. We provide 24/7 uninterrupted and quality power to all our valued customers. We serve 67 lakh households, and we serve the two mega metros, the national capital, Delhi, and the financial capital, Mumbai. This constitutes almost 50% of the private sector market share in the electricity distribution space. Coming to our crown jewel of your company, the Mumbai distribution business, we serve 29 lakh households, which is 2 out of 3 households in Mumbai. We added 65,000 new households in the last financial year. We run one of the lowest AT&C losses in the country. Our AT&C losses, in spite of 50% of customers staying in slums, is at less than 9%, which compares very favorably with the All India average of around 30%. And the benefit of this operation goes to all you consumers. We provide 24/7 reliable and quality power. The average interruption, which is an international metric which is measured, is at less than 20 seconds a day, which is the best in India and among the best in the world. All the HT consumers who had migrated to Tata's owing to the cross-subsidy surcharge not being correct, have, after the tariff getting corrected, have all moved back to your company. We have done a very successful pilot of what we consider cloud-based smart metering, and we expect to roll it out in a phased manner over the next 3 to 4 years. And given our expertise, many state electricity boards utilize our expertise. It is a place where all the utilities come to understand state-of-the-art distribution, and we are providing consultancy to more than 6 states. This clearly is the only city without the need of inverters and gensets. Coming to Delhi distribution, we serve more than 37.5 lakh households. We have added more than 2 lakh households during the last financial year. And if you look from the time that we started the distribution business in Delhi, we have more than doubled the number of consumers in the national capital. Delhi, which was often known as the theft capital of the world, had loss levels exceeding 55% when we took over the distribution. I am proud to say that your company has been able to bring it down to sub 13%. What does this mean to the consumers and the government? The Delhi government and the Delhi consumers have saved 60,000 crores over the last 14 years. And this money has been utilized by the Delhi government through its various infrastructure projects, namely roads, metros, highways, as well as social sector objectives like schools and hospitals. Delhi also, we now provide 24/7 reliable and quality power. From an outage of more than 5 hours a day, our performance is at less than 3 minutes a day, which is an improvement of 100 times. So from 300 minutes a day to less than 3 minutes a day. In 2002, it was normal for more than 200 transformers to blow out every month. And today, there is not even a single case. The sale of gensets, which is a straight number, has come down by 95% in Delhi itself. While we improve performance, operating metrics, quality of power, loss reduction, state-of-the-art technology, we always remember to keep you at the center of all our initiatives. With the advent of mobile, we have leveraged the mobile technology to the hilt. We have our own Reliance Energy and BSES app, which you can download on your mobile phone. And besides having all the features of an app, of seeing your consumption, making a payment, enhancing your load, asking for a new connection, or just putting in a complaint, we heard from you and we have added some unique features like know your Reliance Energy person who has come to your house. Once in a while, when you have had a problem and you've had a person visit you, many of you all had told us that how do we know if the person is genuine? Of course, this issue is much more in Delhi, where a lot of people worked as impostors and fleeced the poor consumers of Delhi. So you see his card, you input his number and his entire name, picture and his full details will come and you'll be absolutely sure. We use the best-in-class billing systems and payment options, multilingual bills, the only utility in the world. So we give you a bill in the language of your choice. Currently there are 4 languages which are available. Electronic bill, mobile wallets, e-payments. There is not a payment method, including Kirana shops, which is offered by any service provider which is not offered by your company. We have a very interactive website, which has been used very actively by all you people. 24/7 toll-free customer care center, multilingual, and support, one number to call for any of your needs. We are also very active on social media, Facebook, YouTube, Twitter, and we are amongst the utility with the highest number of followers on these platforms. Coming to our generation vertical, together with our Reliance Power, which Reliance Infrastructure had promoted, where we own a 43.2% stake, we have a total operating capacity of 6,885 megawatts. Our flagship plant at Dahanu has worked at 100% PLF for 9 out of the last 10 years. It is the benchmark plant in the country and is winner of innumerable awards, both in India and overseas. We also commissioned the 4,000 megawatt Sasan Ultra Mega Power project in Madhya Pradesh 1 year ahead of schedule, which for a plant of its size runs at a load factor of 90% and an availability of almost 100%. It provides the lowest tariff of 1.19 rupees a kilowatt, benefiting 42 crore consumers across 7 states. The total savings to the 14 procuring states is 3,25,000 crores over the life of the plant. Transmission business, all our 3 projects are operational with a total investment of 4,600 crores. These projects in the western region, they enable a flow of more than 4,000 megawatts into the power-starved western region. If you would remember, few years back, Maharashtra was facing a lot of problem in power, and one of the key reasons was power from outside western region could not flow into Maharashtra. With our projects here, this has enabled flow of 4,000 megawatts of power. This business also runs at an availability of 99.8%, which means we earn incentives for all of you. And our projects in Himachal, they have been put up at the highest altitude involving very tough terrain and snowbound areas. Our road business, we are amongst the largest NHAI concessioners. We have 11 projects across 7 states, 1,000 kilometers in length, with a total investment of 11,500 crores. All our road projects are revenue operational. Our EBITDA margins are 90% across our road projects. And even in these difficult times when the economy did not pick up so much, our roads did show a growth of 6% in traffic. Most of our roads connect urban centers, namely Delhi, Bangalore, Jaipur, Gurgaon, Agra. So we are assured of good traffic growth for the entire concession period. We embrace technology. We have the electronic toll collection machine at all our toll plazas. And also to stop the menace of overloaded trucks, which also creates safety issues as well as issue on the quality of the roads, we are one of the very few companies in India which have installed a weigh-in-motion facility at most of our toll plazas, and by the end of this year, it will be in all our toll plazas. Coming to Mumbai Metro, it is the fastest completed infrastructure project in Mumbai. It's an engineering marvel. It is Asia's tallest cable-stayed bridge over Western Express Highway, and we did that without stoppage of a single minute on the highway. We have a 183-meter-long steel bridge over the busiest railway line in the world, namely at the Andheri Junction. 21 crore people have used our metro, and this metro has enabled consumers to travel between Warsaw and Ghatkopar from 120 minutes in the past to barely 21 minutes. We have made more than 2.8 lakh passenger trips during this period. The availability of the trains is at 100%, and the punctuality is a mind-numbing 99.9%. Very safe operations, and like the distribution business, very digital, very connected with social media, with our consumers. Our EPC business, your company has executed more than 50,000 crores worth of projects over the last 10 years. We have done very complex projects within the cost and the time that we were supposed to complete in. Sasan UMPP is the world's largest integrated power and coal project, which was executed by the EPC team of Reliance Infrastructure. We have a center of excellence to enhance the technical capabilities of our team. We have tied up with world leaders in areas of technology like nuclear and marine, so that we can take part in those opportunities as they come. And we have a very, very strong team of very qualified engineers in place. Reliance Defense, which is our new growth initiative, we acquired management control of Pipa Power Defense, which is the largest acquisition in the defense space, and it has now been named at Reliance Defense and Engineering. During our short period of 14 months, your company has received 27 industrial licenses, which is the highest number of licenses received by any company during this period in the defense and aerospace sector. We have done strategic tie-ups with global majors to capitalize on the growth opportunities under Honorable PM's Make in India program. We are in the process of setting up manufacturing facilities at Mihan, Nagpur, and Bhopal on the aerospace sector, Indore SEZ for the land systems, and in Bangalore, a state-of-the-art R&D centers. We have a team of already more than 50 leading professionals in our various verticals. This is a list of the 27 industrial licenses across defense and aerospace, across aerospace, navy, and land systems. This is the highest number of licenses received by any company. Coming to Reliance Defense and Engineering, we have executed the sub-concession agreement, which is now valid up to 2046. This is a unique shipyard known for its capability and capacity. It has got by far the largest dry dock in India and the second largest dry dock in the world, which gives it the capability to do projects which no other shipyard in India can do. It has two Goliath cranes with a lifting capacity of 1,200 tons and in-house fabrication capacity of 144,000 tons. Your company is one of the two private sector companies which have been qualified to bid for the naval projects which will be made available to the private sector. We have won an order for refitting of three naval warships, and we have been declared the L1 bidder for 14 fast patrol vessels for the Indian Coast Guard. We are the first private sector shipyard to build warships for Ministry of Defense. Coming to the CSR human capital, while your company strives for excellence in operations and all operating metrics, we are very deeply committed to the society that we serve in and the environment in which we exist. We started a campaign a few years back known as the Young Energy Savers, in which we have taught the children of Mumbai and Delhi the benefit of energy conservation. We have covered more than 250 schools and 200,000 students have been trained. Surakshit Raho, Khush Raho is again a campaign spread across multiple schools to spread about electricity safety awareness. We provide health programs, medical camps, blood donation, eye camps across all our sites and also in our distribution areas for the underprivileged. On the environmental initiatives, all our employees are involved in the Swachh Bharat Abhiyan. Each one of our facility embraces this very noble objective by the Honorable Prime Minister, and we are a very, very active participant in the Earth Hour, which Bombay and Delhi has got the highest benefit of power reduction during the Earth Hour in the country. Our human capital, which is our lifeline and which are our real assets, we have more than 13,000 young population with 10% women. We believed in skilling and retraining our people from the time we got into the company. We have more than 900 training programs and we have done 37,000 man days of training. This has led to very high revenue productivity from our employees, which is at 1.5 crores per employee. All of the above has led to recognition and awards across each of our businesses as well as each of the functions. So whether it is metro, distribution, transmission, roads, whether it is human relations, safety, environment. With this, I come to the end of the presentation. Thank you.
I now move the ordinary resolution relating to item number 1 of the notice for adoption of standalone and consolidated audited financial statements of the company for the financial year ended March 31, 2016, reports of the auditors thereon, the report of the board of directors, standalone financial statements. Before I put the resolutions to vote, I invite the members to seek clarifications, if any, and offer their comments. I request my colleague Sri Ramesh Shenoy to announce the names of the members to come to the podium. Shenoy.
We begin the meeting first by inviting Sri Sailesh Bhai Mahadevia to the podium. Sailesh Bhai. Followed by Sri Asmuklal Bhai. Sailesh Bhai, please take the other podium.
For your advice, which I value greatly, and your inputs. From a Reliance Group perspective, the Reliance Infra shareholder base of over 11 lakhs is the base that is closest to my heart. This was the first company in which I became chairman in 2003, when it was called BSES, then transformed it to Reliance Energy, now transformed into Reliance Infrastructure. So the journey has been very rewarding, full of learning, and learning about new businesses which I didn't know anything about. I think that what we have done in the last 10 to 15 years in Reliance Infrastructure is going to be completely transformed, and you are going to see a completely new Reliance infrastructure in the next 3 to 5 years. And I hope and I am confident that I will receive the support of each one of you in this journey of the transformation of Reliance infrastructure. I will come to the specific aspects of this transformation, but before that I will answer some of the queries and questions made by shareholders. Shailesh Bhai mentioned about the need for a social impact report. We greatly value that, considering the amount of work we do. You will have an independent and fair report from next year on a social impact report, not only for Reliance Infra, but for the entire group. So if you are a group shareholder, you will see that across all companies. Two, you mentioned about employee surveys and employee satisfaction. This is something that we publish and that we do every year. And if you see our website, you will see those survey results. You asked me a view on the development of the bond markets and its impact. We think that the bond markets are going to get deeper and wider, and it is going to be aimed at more retail. And at the end of the day, there will be a transmission of rates, maturities, products, services out there in the capital markets, where investors at large will have a choice to move away from fixed deposits to other instruments by choice. You made a very impactful point on the dividend policy, and it is mandatory now under the listing guidelines for all companies to have a dividend policy. But more importantly, you mentioned about the dimension about what do you do with retained earnings. How is that being used? Is it being used for growth capital? Is it being used to pay down debt? What is it that we are doing? And I think we will consider that in our dividend policy, which will be published from next year. Every one of you who has been on the Mumbai Metro speaks for itself in terms of quality, reliability, and safety. Convenience is an important aspect, but not at the cost of safety, not at the cost of quality. I think that what we've achieved of building a metro system in a living city of Mumbai is pretty much a record. I have to thank our EPC team, and I have to thank our leadership team at the Mumbai Metro, headed by Abhay Mishra, who is here, for the outstanding job that he and his team are doing at Mumbai Metro. And in 786 days of operations, 200 million people experienced the Mumbai Metro. So I think that it is a record, and it is an excellent suggestion. And sometimes shareholders guide us and read our minds. Considering our expertise and experience of Mumbai, clearly we are looking at a large number of metro systems in Mumbai, in Cochin, in Lucknow, in Nagpur, in other parts of the world, to be an O&M operator. So if we can run a world-class system in Mumbai, there is no reason for us not to go and create this world-class experience in other cities. And this will be a new business for us. It will be a revenue stream. It has no capital intensity, but it has got intellectual capital. It has got knowledge. It has got experience. It has got best practices. And that is what we will bring to the table in terms of trying to develop this area. I was asked about the defense business and the capital intensity of it. Let me cover that as I talk about our defense business. And I was also asked about partnerships in defense, and I'll cover that in defense. Question was asked on what valuations we achieved on the sale of our cement business. There were clearly premium valuations. They're published. We've reported to the stock exchange, and it is there for everybody to see. I think it is part of our focused strategy of future growth, that the pillars of growth will be the EPC business, the O&M business, the business of our power business, which we have, which is generation, transmission, distribution, and the defense business. So those will be the four pillars of growth which will lead the transformation of Reliance Infrastructure into a very, very different company in the coming years to come. Let me cover, since I've answered all the queries from shareholders, let me talk a little about the defense business. This is a business that is new to the private sector. This is a business that has been liberalized and opened up only in 2014 when Prime Minister Modi took charge of the country. With his policies of Make in India, of Skill India, of a Digital India, of a Swachh Bharat India, and his policies of embracing technology, the liberal foreign direct investment regime that we've got in defense. These are the key drivers for private sector participation in defense. So it's a new sector. We are all toddlers and babies in this business. So we are in the business of learning. So if you asked me a year ago about defense businesses, I would know nothing. Today I know something, but I'm still in the learning process. And we ultimately depend on the intellectual capital of people who have served us in the Army, in the Navy, in the Air Force, like Admiral Malli and so many other people who have joined Reliance Defense in pushing forward with our defense vision. I think that India is one of the largest importers of defense equipment in the world, and that has to change. I think that the opportunity is so large that whether it is 5 lakh crores or 10 lakh crores, it is meaningless to rattle out any of those numbers. I think that our effort and our vision really is something that I believe would have made my father very, very proud. We're looking at an integrated play in the defense sector, a play across all the verticals of the Army, Navy, and the Air Force. To play the naval sector, the only way you can do that is if you own a shipyard. And that's the first thing that we did last year to show our seriousness, to show our commitment. We acquired control of Pipavav of Defense, which is now renamed as Reliance Defense and Engineering Limited. And that will be the center of excellence as far as we are concerned for everything to do with the naval opportunities. There are only two companies in India, one being Reliance Defense, that has now been approved by the Ministry of Defense, accepted by the Indian Navy, to build warships, to build submarines, to refit existing warships and existing submarines. We've had the Germans, the Russians, the French all come and survey the Pipavav yard, and all of them have certified it as a world-class yard, and all of them have expressed their desire and have actually signed MOUs with us to come and work with us in India and transfer technology, train our people, and of course also provide capital. So capital is the least constraint in the defense sector. It is not as capital intensive as most people think, capital is provided by the customer, in this case the Ministry of Defense. There are staged payments. So it is a medium to light capital intensive business. It is not like building 4,000 megawatts at Sasan, which cost us 30,000 crores. I don't think we can spend 30,000 crores in the next 30 years in the defense sector. I don't think that that's going to be there. So that is as far as the naval side is concerned. And only recently, and shortly I should say, we would be signing a contract with the Indian Coast Guard for the first defense order from them to a private sector company for 14 fast patrol vessels at a cost of about 1,000 crores. The Navy has recently sent 3 of their ships for refits to Pipavav. So we are now getting into the know of what is going on in the sector. And we have bids out there and shortly tenders to be open for projects on the naval side for a value of over 10,000 crores. So we are deeply engaged, we are deeply involved, and we are deeply committed to the defense sector. The Government of India is pursuing several initiatives to promote Make in India, to see that Indian private sector participates in the defense sector. I'll just give you an example. There are 5 public sector shipyards which are owned by the Ministry of Defense. They have 200,000 crores worth of orders. On an average, they're running 10 years late on all programs. So now, the opportunity is there for the private sector to come in and work with the public sector, work with the government to strengthen their arms, to expedite deliveries, to learn and to produce quality and at competitive costs. So I'm just speaking about the scale of the opportunity that is in front of us. I think that while we are pursuing several opportunities in India on the naval side, we are also pursuing foreign military sales, which is effectively selling defense naval equipment to other governments, other countries outside India, and our teams are engaged in multiple opportunities which we hope we will realize over the next few years. I think that the Government of India is pursuing a program called Strategic Partnerships in the private sector. It's a program that we endorse, and we are one amongst the 2 that would qualify for a submarine program. It is an order for 6 submarines with a value of over 60,000 crores. So I think that we take great pride that we will be able to transform Pipavav Defense, now Reliance Defense, into a world-class naval facility, both for warships and submarines, and I hope we will make India self-sufficient and very, very proud. We have similar initiatives on the land system sides, which is the army side, and we also have on the aerospace side. I want to make a mention, since I was asked by one of the shareholders about working with Israel. We've signed 2 joint ventures with Israel. One is with a company called Rafael, which is one of the largest and world leaders in missile technology, and we will be making missiles in India for the armed forces. The second one is a joint venture with a leading company in Israel called Elbit. This focuses on homeland security and border management. For example, if we had a world-class border management infrastructure, we could have avoided, at one level at least, an attack on Pathankot. At another level, we could have prevented or early warned or restricted an attack on Uri. I think that these are, again, game-changing events. These are adoption of world-class practices, which includes thermal imaging, night vision, and bring the best technology and practices to bear. We have recently bid for a tender for the border security force for creating fencing and to bring world-class practices. So this is a deep defense ocean, and we are just learning to fish, in spite of the fact that I'm still a vegetarian. So I'm just learning to fish. I think that clearly I spoke about the four legs that we look at the future. And in order to be very, very focused and clear, we are effectively figuring out what is non-core to us. So we believe cement was non-core. We sold it at a premium valuation and realized and paid down debt. We believe that we have developed the largest road portfolio. Now there are options, as you may have seen, that we have applied for an investment trust to SEBI. A EGM notice has been sent to all shareholders to get their shareholders' approval. And these are world practices of monetization. And this is how infrastructure companies do it all over the world. In the past, Indian companies would have to go to Singapore or London to do a trust. And we kept on telling the government, why can't you create the same regulation in India? We don't want to go to Singapore, we don't want to go to London, provided we have the same infrastructure in India and the same investment regime in India. Now, the government is aligned all laws, all rules, all regulations to be on par with whatever is there in the world, and that is why it gives us an opportunity to consider an investment trust, and this is fantastic news for investors because they can get a diversified portfolio, tax-free rates of return, and high yields coming out from the investment trust. So that is what we are looking at in terms of our roads business. Lalit, in his presentation, spoke about a minority stake sale in our power distribution business. All valuations are done independently. All valuations are done fairly. All valuations are done, in terms of what is the real market. And we will not, and we have never, ever compromised on shareholders' interest, and we will not do that. So we hope that the roads business and the Mumbai distribution business will further bring focus to our four legs and the four pillars that I described. Also, as some of you may be aware, that India, after more than 60 years, has changed its arbitration laws. So if I start counting the changes that we have seen in the last 2.5 years done by Prime Minister Modi and this government, they are simply mind-boggling. There was not a single reason to change the arbitration law, but all the arbitration laws have been changed and they are now on par with global arbitration standards. We have now 14,000 crores worth of arbitration at very advanced stages, and hopefully, if we win them, there is now a government diktat that any order that is won and is against a PSU or a government undertaking, they have to pay you 75%. They can keep fighting it legally. We have no problems with that. We will secure them with a bank guarantee, but it will bring in the liquidity into the system, into the company, to reduce debt, to reduce NPAs of banks, to give liquidity, and to reduce our overall costs. So I think that we expect that based on all these initiatives, and Lalit said this in his presentation, my clear vision is we are moving towards making Reliance Infra debt-free at a standalone level. That is a journey, that is a transformation that nobody has ever attempted in India. Thank you so much. As required, the company has provided e-voting facilities to all the members of the company from September 24, 2016 to September 26, 2016. The voting rights of the members are in proportion to the number of shares held by them as on the date cutoff, being September 20. The voting through physical ballot has also been made available to the members who attend the AGM and who have not already cast their votes by e-voting. The board of